right, we've got one more talk, and this one is really, really exciting. This person, Franziska Hinkelmann, is, I mean, I know we don't like to talk about like rockstar developers, ninja developers, but dude, she's really like, real badass. She has a PhD in mathematics, which like, raise your hand if you have a PhD in math, right? She does. Not only that, she's on the technical steering committee for Node.js. She is an open contributor, or an open source contributor for Node. She has contributed to the V8 engine for JavaScript. O sea, super, super, super calificada. And she's going to be talking to us a bit about performance. I haven't mentioned this yet, but performance is a really big part of web accessibility. Web accessibility is making sure that our sites are optimized for everyone and everyone's experiences and situations. So when we can make our sites and our apps faster, that means that we can ensure that more people have access to it. So I am personally super excited for this. She is one of our keynote speakers. So let's make sure we give her the biggest round of applause for Franziska Hinkelmann.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for having me. You're an incredibly warm and welcoming community, and it's truly an honor to be part of your conference. Thank you. So I talk about JavaScript compilers. We'll look at how the performance of modern JavaScript compares to the performance of C++, and where WebAssembly fits into this performance discussion. And now, you might be wondering, why would I care about JavaScript compilers on a Saturday evening? Like, you don't directly interact with the compiler. It's just there doing its job, parsing your code, running it. Doesn't matter what browser, they're all super good JavaScript compilers now. Node has the same compiler as Chrome. Like, usually you shouldn't care about it. But it's kind of like driving. You don't need to know anything. You don't need to be a mechanic to drive a car, right? You can just go on and drive. But if you do know what's happening under the hood, that can make you a better driver. And it's exactly the same for being a JavaScript developer. You don't need to know what the compiler does. You can learn the syntax, you can follow all the best practices, you can learn the framework. But if you have a little bit of an idea of the underlying concepts of the JavaScript compiler, that will help you to be a better developer. So I hope you bear with me going deep down into the engine of your JavaScript code. I'm mostly speaking about Node performance, but then the compiler in Node, Chrome V8 is the same in Chrome, and the concepts I'm talking about, they're actually pretty much the same in all the modern JavaScript engines. So it doesn't matter if it's V8 in Chrome, if it's Chakra Core in Microsoft Edge, if it's WebKit in Safari, if it's SpiderMonkey in Mozilla Firefox, the concepts we're covering, they're the same in those engines. I do talk about performance, but I'm focusing only on runtime performance. So we saw a talk yesterday where we waited for 90 seconds for LinkedIn to wait. This is not the kind of performance I'm talking about. So I'm not talking about download the size of your web bundles or the images, how you can pre-process them to make it faster. I'm not talking about I/O databases, different HTTP versions, or different ways to render, or different frameworks. I'm focusing only on the runtime performance. So how fast is the JavaScript itself running? And how fast would the same calculation be in C++ and in WebAssembly? Never ever optimize prematurely. You're making your code base so ugly. Well, in the best case, you make it ugly, but you're probably making it wrong. So whenever you want to optimize, measure first, make sure you optimize the right thing, and then measure again to make sure it actually got better. So nobody go back on Monday and rewrite everything in WebAssembly, okay? Promise? Okay, so warnings out of the way. Before we can talk about performance, I want to point out one fundamental difference between a scripting language like JavaScript and a compiled language like C++. So in JavaScript, you can create objects and then you can set fields on this object. So my object has a property X and it has a value. Can you do the same thing in C++? Yeah, kind of. The difference in C++ is before you can set this X property, you have to tell the compiler about this object class. So before you can set object.x, you would have to define a class in C++. So don't worry if you are not familiar with C++, we won't go much deeper than this. Just know before you can set this value in C++, you first have to tell the compiler this is exactly what the class looks like, and then you can instantiate an object, set the value to 42. Now, in JavaScript, you can write some more code, and then you say, oh, my object also needs a property y, let me add that to the object, everything's fine. You try to do that in C++, the compiler will not compile this. You have to know upfront exactly what the properties are, and you have to tell very specifically to the compiler that you want this. So a language like JavaScript is called dynamically typed because the type of this object is super dynamic. At any point, you can change the type. You can add X's and Y's and Z's. You can delete the X's. So it's super dynamic. C++, not so much dynamic. It's called statically typed. The types are super fixed. You write them out first at compile time, and then you can change them later on dynamically. Both these concepts have their pros and cons, and that's why we have languages, why we have successful languages that are dynamically typed and successful languages that are statically typed. So in JavaScript, this dynamic typing can be really nice for when you do rapid prototyping. You don't want to need to know exactly upfront what to do. You just want to be fairly quick and prototype something. When you work with formats like JSON, that would be super hard in a statically typed language. Imagine you're getting a JSON over the web, and you would have to know upfront all the properties in it, because otherwise you couldn't create an object. And also, this dynamic typing can oftentimes be really helpful when you're just learning programming. Like, you don't have an angry compiler that complains about the why, it just kind of works and it's more forgiving. So, great, why don't we always use only dynamically typed languages? Well, it can be really, really useful for us humans, but for the compiler, this dynamic typing is actually a ton more work. And that's why a language like C++ first makes you write out the type, the layout, the memory layout of an object, so that the compiler knows what it will need to work with later. Think about in JavaScript, if you do a property lookup, this is super simple, property.x. You have this all over your code. Even if you do console.log, the compiler has to look up the log property on the console object. So you do this a million times, even if you just have a little bit of code. Now, for us, this is simple. We are trying to get this property. We don't really care whether it was defined. Like, we're just trying to get it. From a point of view from the compiler that has to follow the JavaScript specification, there's a ton of things that could happen here. Could throw a type error, object might not have this property, it might have it, but it might be up on the prototype chain. Object might be a proxy with a get trap, so there have to be this get trap that needs to be invoked when you try to get the property. Might have been defined with an accessor descriptor, like just going through the basic things that could happen here, that's already a ton, and the compiler has to make sure it's checking for all these steps. And moreover, when the compiler needs to access X from this object, it doesn't know the memory layout of object. So even if it knows where the object is, it doesn't know at which point in memory is the value for X. And that's where in C++, by defining that upfront, it's very easy for the compiler. It knows right away, oh, X is at this position, and it can just grab the value. So in JavaScript, that's a lot of work. We as humans don't really have to deal with it, but the compiler has to do a lot of work to do something this simple. You've probably heard of the ECMA script specification, ES, that's why we talk about ES2.16 and so on. That's the specification that defines what JavaScript has to do to be valid JavaScript. And don't bother reading this, I just want to show that just a simple property lookup is a ton of steps in the specification, and actually every little item here has another like long stack of things it needs to do. So getting something like object.x is like lots of work for a compiler in JavaScript. So what's your intuition about JavaScript? Do you think it's fast if doing something like object.x takes forever? Is this the JavaScript? I think 15 years ago, that maybe was JavaScript, but let's look at some actual data. So I calculated prime numbers, the first 1 million prime numbers, and I timed JavaScript, and I used exactly the same, actually kind of stupid algorithm in C++, so exactly the same algorithm, no cheating there, and I compiled it with the optimization flag on and timed that, and the results are really amazing. So red is C++, blue is JavaScript, and yes, JavaScript is a little slower, but it's the same ballpark as C++. If you look at the 1 millionth prime number that I computed, it took 8 seconds in C++ and like 16 seconds in JavaScript. That's a factor too. Like that's really okay if you think about the million steps that your poor compiler has to do just to do a property.x lookup. So modern JavaScript is actually super, super fast when you consider that it's dynamically typed. So let's dive in. How do modern JavaScript compilers give us this amazing speed? So the trick that all these modern compilers use is so-called just-in-time compilation, JIT compilation. And that means the compiler is compiling code just in time as it needs to run it. It's sometimes called lazy compilation because it's not doing all the work ahead of time and then you can run it. No, it's super lazy. It's doing the bare minimum and only when you need it. So in pretty much any language, the compiler toolchain looks like this. You have source code, and then the parser of the compiler transfers the source code usually into an abstract syntax tree, an AST. That's just a different representation of your source code that's easier to understand by computer programs than the actual source code. And then the interpreter or compiler, depends on the language and the context what you call that, takes this abstract syntax tree and generates machine code, something that can be executed on your CPU. Now for just-in-time compilers, it's not a straight line anymore, it's a messy loop at the bottom. So you still have to parser, generate an abstract syntax tree, but then the just-in-time compiler compiles a little bit, then we run a little bit of machine code, then it compiles some more, and then we run some more machine code. Okay, this sounds super messy. How is this faster than having a straight line doing all the work up front and being done with it? So the trick is, by alternating runtime and compile time, the compiler gathers information at runtime and then uses that special information the next time it's compiling to generate better code. Does that make sense? A little bit? So instead of compiling everything, it compiles a little bit, runs it, gathers information, and then it's speculating that the kind of stuff it sees now will be the same in the future, so the compiler uses those speculations to optimize other code that it's compiling. Say you're in traffic planning, and you want to plan a parade, and you don't want to cause big trouble in traffic. Now, you could take a map of the city and study it for 2 weeks, and then decide which streets to shut off, and then have the parade, and it's probably a big disaster. Or you could have the map, but only look at small parts, and then look at traffic on Monday. And then look a little more at the streets, look at traffic on Tuesday and on Wednesday, and then based on what you saw on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, you make your decision on the parade which streets to cut off. That's probably much better than if you've only looked at the static map before. So this is what the compiler is basically doing. It's not compiling all your code, it's compiling some. It's checking for feedback while it's running that, and then it's recompiling using that feedback. Those speculative optimizations. So this is giving us a much better performance than what we had 1 or 2 decades ago. But there's another trick that all the modern engines use, and that is they don't have one compiler, they have at least 2 compilers. Some even have 3 compilers. They always have a baseline compiler, and then they have an optimizing compiler. And the way it works is the baseline compiler compiles the functions that you're running, but it keeps track at runtime how often a function is being run. And when it's run a lot, when it's a hot function, then the optimizing compiler takes over and generates faster machine code using some of these speculations that it can make because it already observed the function at runtime. And if it turns out that the speculations that it made about the kind of input it will see in the future, if it turns out that that's wrong, then we just de-optimize and go back to the baseline compiler. So your code will not be wrong, it will just be slower until it can be optimized again. So, super fast JavaScript. Okay. Let's look at some actual example. Here's a function add, and it returns 1 plus object.x. You can tell I write really complicated JavaScript. So how does this look for the compiler? We have the source code, the parser turns this into an abstract syntax tree, and now when we're running this function, the baseline compiler compiles it for the first time. If we never run it, the compiler doesn't even compile it because it's a lazy compiler. So we're running this function a few times, and we're always calling it with a normal object that has a property x and no other properties. So we've been calling this function a few times, and the first time we call it, the baseline compiler generates machine code, so this is the code executed as you run the function. Now we're calling this function a ton of times, so at some point the optimizing compiler will take over. It will recompile this function and generate machine codes that's faster than the one that the baseline compiler generated. And when the optimizing compiler compiles the add function, the magic trick now is that it's using the information that we gathered at runtime. When the function was run before, the information collected was that the input was always an object that was a normal object, nothing weird on the prototype chain, and that object always only had the property x. So this particular speculation that will happen in the future too goes into when the compiler generates this optimized machine code. And this code runs much faster than the one on the left when you're executing the add function. What could happen here, though? Well, at any point in the future, somewhere else in the code, it might say add an object that only has a y and no x. And this optimized machine code only works for this other type of object. So no big deal, we just de-optimize, go back to the somewhat slower machine code generated by the baseline. It's not wrong, we just cannot stay on the fast machine code. Who here knows assembly code? Okay, in like 2 minutes, everybody will know it. The left is the machine code generated by this baseline compiler on the left, and this actually goes on for a few more pages. I just couldn't fit it on here. These 4 instructions on the right are the machine code for the add function generated by the optimizing compiler. So this is the Chrome V8 JavaScript compiler generating x86 assembly, but it looks kind of similar on other architectures. And so bear with me for just a minute to understand these instructions. The first one, CMP, stands for compare, and this instruction is comparing that the shape of the input is this object with an x in it. So it's just comparing that the input matches that speculation that we put in when we're generating this code. If that comparison fails, then we do a jump bailout. We're jumping to another position and we're bailing out from the optimizing compiler, going back to the de-optimizing compiler. If the comparison was true, then we move on to move, the third instruction, and move is moving this position on the right-hand side into the RBX register. So that's actually where you can find the property X, where you can find the value. It's at this location. We're moving this into RBX. On the last line add, that's the addition where we did 1 plus that X value. So hopefully you see that these 4 instructions is way faster than doing hundreds of instructions when you just want to do 1 plus object at X. And it is in fact a lot faster. So I ran Node or Chrome with dash dash no opt, so turning off the optimizing compiler, and you can see how incredibly slow that is. So by having information from the runtime and then using it to speculate what you'll see in the future and optimizing for that with the optimizing compiler, we are now almost as fast as C++, like it was maybe a factor two slower, versus without that we would be 10 times slower. And you can imagine if you have a big React app or a Node server, if you had that speed at the top, you wouldn't really get anywhere. So it's really cool that our JavaScript engines can give us this kind of performance. And if you zoom in on the very left with the first few prime numbers that this is calculating, this is super cool because you can actually, you can see the optimizing compiler. Like, we had all this theory, but if you look at the measurements, you can see where the optimizing compiler is. So when we start off, JavaScript is way slower than C++. And that's because the code that was generated is this slow baseline machine code. And then, so it gets slower, and all of a sudden it drops down to almost C++ speed. So at this point, the baseline compiler, running the code, collected enough information so that we could recompile with the optimizing compiler, and running that machine code is now almost as fast as C++. I just love this because it's like, oh, so much theory, and the code base is massive and messy. But then you look at this and you're like, oh, that's the optimizing compiler kicking in. Okay. If you want to play around with it, if you have Node installed, you can just do Node dash dash trace opt or trace deopt. That will show you when a function is optimized and also when it's deoptimized, and it might even give you a reason why it had to be deoptimized. You can also do that in Chrome. You just start Chrome from the command line and then you do dash dash js flags equals trace opt trace deopt. Or if you want to see more assembly code, you can do dash dash print opt code and it'll give you like way more information than you want. All right, so I was comparing JavaScript to C++, and if you are a Node developer, you might know that you can actually write C++ modules for Node.js. They're called Node.js add-ons or native add-ons, C++ add-ons. As a user, you use them exactly like a JavaScript module. You might not even know it, but you can write C++ code, and then you have to provide a special bindings file, and then anybody who's using your module can interact with it just like they do with any JavaScript module. And I'm sure you're using those modules without even knowing it that they're C++ if you run any Node code. So some examples are Node Sass, so it's really C++ code, it's not all JavaScript code, or gRPC, a lot of cryptography libraries, they're using C++ like Decrypt, and then databases like SQL. And native add-ons, they're officially a part of Node.js, so if you go to the official Node.js.org website, there's a ton of documentation on how to get started. It's fun if you want to try out something new, see if you can write some C++ and use it as JavaScript. Obviously, this does not work in the browser, this is Node-specific. So what do you do in the browser? So you can use WebAssembly. WebAssembly is a portable binary format for the web. So portable means it runs everywhere. It's not only Linux or only Windows or only Mac. It's portable, and it's binary. That means it's not for you, it's for the machine. And it's for the web. Well, we know what the web means. So that's really awesome. And the way WebAssembly came about is that all the big browser vendors came together and agreed on it, and they're working collaboratively collaboratively on the specification and the implementation. So when you do run WebAssembly code, you don't have to worry about, oh, is this going to work in Chrome? Yes, because we're all sticking to the same specification at this point. And the WebAssembly support in Chrome is in V8, the JavaScript engine, which is also a Node. So if you write Node, you can also write WebAssembly modules, which is pretty nice. And you can compile almost any language to WebAssembly. So C++ is the most obvious, but there's also Rust and Go and Lua and Java. Like, there's compilers out there for all of those, so you can write Go code and then compile it to WebAssembly, this binary format for the web. And one nice thing here is that you can debug it when you write a C++ add-on and then you run it in Node. It can sometimes be a little hard if you're tracking down bugs, but in WebAssembly that's a lot nicer. So what is the performance of WebAssembly? So I took the C++ code that I already had and I compiled it to this new binary format for the web so that I can run it in the web. And I did some performance measurements when I calculated the first 1 million prime numbers. And WebAssembly, it's a little slower than C++, but it is faster than JavaScript. So it's a little slower than C++ because there's always a bit of overhead when you're calling into WebAssembly, but it is faster than JavaScript because it's not JIT compiled. It's not a dynamically typed language. So in conclusion, modern JavaScript is super fast. Like, yes, it was slower, but less than a factor two slower. So pretty much all applications, unless you do something extremely computationally heavy, it's probably not an issue for your user that your runtime performance is a little slower than what you could be getting with C++. So that is really nice because it means you can write JavaScript code, you don't have to learn a different syntax, you don't have to introduce another build tool, you can use all the same tools, your deployment steps will stay easy. So the JavaScript compilers are doing a lot for us, and most of the time we can just stick with JavaScript. If you do need the extra performance and you're not in the browser but in Node, you can write C++ code and use a native module, so it's a little bit faster if you really need that. And if you need that on the web, then WebAssembly is a really good choice. Well, probably also the only choice. But WebAssembly gives you almost the same performance as you have in C++. And it runs on the browser, which the native modules don't. And don't optimize unless you really know you have a performance issue and then measure making sure you're fixing the right issue. Thank you.